So our speaker today will be Professor Subir Sachdev of Harvard University. I'll say more about him in a second, but first I want to recognize the sponsor of the lecture series, Chet Peterson, proud K-State alum, aviator, businessman, author, and real champion of science for Kansas State University, our physics department, and the whole state as well. So could we please give Chet a hand? And we'd like to present our speaker, Professor Sachdev, with a remembrance for his journey to K-State, which was a little bit arduous. Sorry about that. Midwestern weather. So just come over here.
Right here. Okay.
Yeah.
Sir, I am honored to present
this. This is my honor. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Let's go.
Thank you very much.
All right, so before I'll spend a few more words on Chet before I introduce Dr. Sacha, and we're certainly very happy to have Chet's wife Mary here as well, so thank you for coming to this event. So as you can see, Chet's hobbling around a little bit, some sort of misadventure. I didn't ask about the details, but something went wrong with his foot. So Chet has a son who, we don't have a medical school here, so he had to go to some school to the east. I forget what it's called. It does have a medical school. Chet went over there to get surgery done to correct his foot. And I think his son is on the staff of that institution over there. I think the surgery went very well. Oh, Wichita. Sorry, it was down in Wichita. Surgery went very, very well. But Chet woke up, and I guess he was a little groggy at first and was looking around and finally looked at his hand and looked at his fingernails, and there was this shocking pattern of this horrid combination of red and blue that's associated with, you know, that place 80 miles to the east of us. That would be our friends at the University of Kansas. So Chet, being a good K-Stater, wants one thing. He wants to get even, and he's looking for ideas. So if you have any, please let him know. So this deserves an appropriate response. So we're very happy to, again, getting back to our talk. Welcome Professor Sachdev from Harvard University, where he holds the position of the Herschel Smith Professor of Physics. This year, he's a distinguished visiting professor at the Institute of Advanced Study at Princeton University. Professor Sachdev received his bachelor's degree at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in Cambridge, and then his graduate degrees at Harvard University, his master's and his PhD. He's had a long and distinguished career in research that he'll tell you a little bit about. Among his recognitions are a membership in the United States in our National Academy of Science in the United States of America and the National Academy of Science of India. He's received the Lars Onsager Prize of the American Physical Society, and he's received the Dirac Medal from the International Center for Theoretical Physics in Trieste, among many, many other rewards. So it's really our pleasure to welcome Professor Subir Sachdev to Kansas State University for the Peterson Lecture. Welcome. Okay.
Okay, is my mic working? Okay, great. Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction and for the invitation to visit here. And thank you, Mr. and Mrs. Peterson, for sponsoring this visit and these lectures. So I've had a wonderful 2 days here in Kansas State. First time in the state of Kansas, really. And I thought it'd be completely flat and boring. It's anything but. Very beautiful. So thank you very much for your kind hospitality. All right, so we'll get started. So this is meant to be a general lecture for people who have perhaps a high school education in physics, and so I apologize in advance to many more accomplished people who know not more about physics, but maybe you'll find something of interest to you. I'm happy to have questions. I guess there'll be questions towards the end, but if something is bothering you, just raise your hand. Happy to discuss it. Okay. So the theme of my talk is really about how, in some sense, the same basic principles of physics apply on very, very different length scales. And that's really one of the amazing things about modern science is we can reduce everything down to some very simple principles, and they seem to describe an incredibly wide range of phenomena. And really, the first example of this was Newton in 1687, where really for the first time, he asserted that the same laws applied to planets moving around the sun. You know, the planets are named after gods, so the same laws applied to the gods in heaven as applied to an apple falling from a tree. You could write down exactly the same equations, and over very different length scales, from 1 meter to a trillion meters, you had exactly the same laws. So these were what we call Newton's laws of motion, although that wasn't his discovery. But the law of gravitation, being the common denominator in these phenomena, was certainly his great contribution. So now, given Newton's discovery, you could then ask, you know, what the history of short history of physics since 1687 has been. Well, can we extend this range? Can we go to bigger sizes, and can we go to smaller sizes? And do the same laws still apply? So when you go to even smaller sizes, that's we'll go small first. Eventually, you can go down to a dust particle and go even smaller. You find the laws continue to apply. And it's not until you get down to a single atom. So the fact that there's an atom of a certain size, of around 10 to the raised minus 10 meters, was only something understood in the early part of the 20th century, in the 1910s and 1920s. And people started studying the simplest atom, which is the hydrogen atom with one positively charged nucleus and one electron moving around it. So this looks suspiciously like Earth moving around the sun. So why shouldn't the same laws apply? Could I apply Newton's laws to this system of an electron moving around a nucleus? And the answer is no. This is where they really almost completely break down, although some vestiges of it survive for bigger atoms. So we needed an entirely new theory to describe the motion of the electron around the nucleus to replace Newton's laws, which seem to apply, you know, at bigger scales, all the way from a big molecule to the planets. Okay, so what is that theory? Well, we do have a very well-defined theory. It goes, I guess, the two people who formulated it in its most precise form were Schrödinger and Heisenberg in 1925. And the remarkable thing is that theory, which we call the quantum theory, as far as we know today, is completely correct. There's been many, you know, many discoveries in physics since 1925. There's been the understanding of relativity, there's been the understanding of general relativity, gravitation, discovery of new particles, discovery of quarks. There's a huge list of new things that have been discovered in physics. But the basic principles that first came about in the theory of Schrödinger and Heisenberg, as far as we can tell, are completely applicable, and no experiment has ever seen any deviation from them, from any scale going down to the smallest, to, you know, big astrophysics physical scales too. So it's really, in many ways, the most successful theory ever of anything that we have. But despite being so successful in explaining many phenomena, for example, it'll precisely explain the spectrum of light that comes out of a single atom of hydrogen. If you put it in a discharge tube and you see light coming out, it comes out at very discrete frequencies. It can predict exactly those frequencies to ridiculously high precision once you put in relativistic corrections. So the theory is right. There's really no question. But nevertheless, it has some bizarre features, which are very counterintuitive to us. And we're still learning to deal with them and understand some of the consequences. So I'm not going to question this theory. I believe it's correct. But there are still some rather bizarre features that I want to now highlight, which really go back to our best understanding of what the universe is around us. So So for my purposes, I'm also going to try to refer to what's called the spin of the electron. So we know the electron spins on its own axis. And for complicated reasons I won't go into, you can think of the electron as having only two possible spin states, say clockwise and anticlockwise. And I'll represent those states as up and down. So the spin of the electron is, in some sense, the very simplest quantum system, even simpler than the spin of a top under Newton's equations. It just has two states, two possible configurations, up or down. And this has turned out to be a very useful degree of freedom from which you can try to understand the essence of quantum mechanics. Okay, so what is the basic new principle that was introduced by Schrödinger and Heisenberg, and some people before them, but they formulated it in the most precise way, which is not present at all in the Newton's theory. It's an entirely new concept which wouldn't make any sense in the Newtonian view of the universe. And that's the principle of superposition. So in the Newtonian theory, you specify the state of the universe by giving the position and velocity of everything. You know, something is here, and you know exactly where it is and how fast it's moving. You make a list of all these phenomena, so that gives you the state of the universe at a given time. And in principle, if you know the state, now you know it forever. You could put it on a computer and integrate Newton's equations and figure out the future forever. That's an impossible task, but at least in principle, that's the Newtonian view of the universe. However, in quantum theory, we have an entirely new concept. Yes, you have the concept of a state, that an electron is in a certain state. Say it's spin up. And there's another state, which is spin down. These are two distinct states. That makes sense in the Newtonian point of view. But there's also the concept of superposition, that a system can be in a state in more than one state at a time. It can be in as the sum of the two states. So you can add and subtract states. This is not something you could do in Newtonian mechanics. It doesn't even make sense. So that's the idea. And this leads to a lot of very counterintuitive phenomena, which, you know, after you're studying quantum theory for a while, become natural. But initially, certainly in the early days of quantum mechanics, they seem too shocking for many people, including Einstein, as I'll discuss. So the most famous example of which illustrates superposition principle is the famous double slit experiment. So here you have water waves coming through two slits, and water waves interfere. You get this strange pattern. So if you were to look at the intensity of the waves on the screen over here, there'd be certain regions where the red points, where the oscillation of the water wave is very large, and the black points where it hardly oscillates at all. So that's what's called the interference pattern of water waves. Now, what you do is you make an electron gun, and this is actually results of an actual experiment. You take an electron source, as in the old TV tubes, and you send it through these slits. And you don't know what's happening in between, but you look at what you're seeing on this side. So you see a remarkable phenomenon where, in some respects, the electron behaves like a wave, and in other respects, it behaves like a particle. So how does it look like a particle? Well, you see the electrons arrive one by one. So you're sending many, and each dot that you're seeing on the right is an electron hitting the screen. So electron, that looks like a particle. It's like you send in a bullet, and it came out at a given spot. On the other hand, if you look at the distribution of the many electrons, this pattern is called, it precisely reproduces the wave-like interference that water waves would form. So that's the experiment that you can go on YouTube and say double slit experiment. You will see the actual data from experiments. That's where I got this from. So this is the kind of experiment perhaps in your advanced physics lab you can do here. So, and that illustrates the basic idea of superposition. So how do we understand it? Well, the simple way of understanding it is as you're sending in these electrons, when it passes through these two slits, there are two possible states of the electron, a fixed electron, one electron. There's a state where it goes to the left, And there's a state where the same electron goes to the right. And the way this experiment is set up, the actual state of the electron is left plus right at a given position on the screen. As you move to different positions, the sign between them will change. But so that's superposition, that electrons really goes through both. It's neither here nor there. It's really both. And only then can we understand this pattern. So even though it's a single electron, which makes a single blip on the screen, it, in a sense, interferes with itself, the two possible routes it could take to get there. And it takes both. All right. So that seems impossible to accept. But that is the basic principle from which all these successes of quantum theory have been built. OK. So one obvious question you can ask, what happens? But I can look for the electron. I can try to shine a light on the electrons and see which one it went through. Well, what happens, yes, if you look for it and you see it go through the slit, that completely gets rid of the interference pattern. So if you know which one it went through, you've kind of collapsed the state, as we say, of the electron. And so then you don't have an interference. But if you don't look, you see the interference. Anyway, so that's quantum mechanics 101, the principle of superposition. And once you accept this, lots of things follow, including a completely successful description of the spectrum of hydrogen. Okay. All right, so people, of course, have tried very hard to get rid of this strange superposition idea and still reproduce the successes of say, the spectrum of hydrogen. And so this was a big effort in the 30s and 40s and even 50s and 60s. Slowly, all the efforts fell by the wayside. And today, there's nothing left standing except the original quantum theory for many, many reasons. I won't go into that in my talk today anyway. Okay. All right, so among the people who were bothered by this was the famous scientist Einstein himself. And in 1935, this is 20 years after the basic quantum mechanics was discovered and many, many successes have been recorded. So at this point, Einstein was still having trouble with this idea of superposition. And his colleagues, Podolsky and Rosen, I've heard that this paper was the product of a conversation at tea time at this institute, which is still going on today, which I'm happy to attend occasionally. Maybe something interesting will happen. Anyway, so as you can see from the title, they don't think there's anything wrong with quantum mechanics. That would be too radical a position because of all the things it gets right. But they said there must be some improvement. Maybe it's not complete. That's a polite way of saying we don't believe it. But okay, this is what Einstein said. And in this paper, they proposed a thought experiment, which really made the thing even more ridiculous, at least in the intuitive physical sense. And that's the idea of entanglement. So they said, well, let's take the idea of superposition. It's the same idea, but apply it to more than one electron. Okay. So instead of taking a single electron, say, in a hydrogen atom, let's look at a hydrogen molecule, which has two electrons. And a gross simplification of the state of the electrons in a hydrogen molecule is this very simple state here. It's a superposition of two states, where the left electron is up and the right is down, and there's a minus sign for reasons I won't go into, with the opposite orientation of spins. And really, the quantum mechanics says it's neither but both. It's neither this way nor that way, it's both, with a minus sign between them. That's what's happening in every hydrogen molecule. In fact, in every covalent bond that you learn about in chemistry is made up of an entangled pair of electrons in this simplified state. Okay, so maybe we're willing to accept that that's what's going on inside a little molecule. But what EPR, Einstein, Podolsky, Rosen suggested, now imagine I take this molecule and I separate the two electrons. And I very carefully separate in a way that I don't disturb their spin. So, there's ways of doing that. So imagine I can separate them. So I separate them so that one is here with me and the other say, goes to the moon. And while I'm separating them, you know, very far apart, I am not disturbing the spin. So quantum mechanics says that those two electrons are still entangled. Okay, so they're really in this superposition state. So now you have superposition not on some tiny little scale, but on a macroscopic scale, where you have this electron in my hand being spun up or down, I don't know. But what I do know is if mine is down, the other one's up, and vice versa. So these pair of electrons are entangled. Okay, so now I have an electron with me, and I look at it. Well, as I told you, it's in a superposition state. When I look at it, I will see either up or down. I don't know ahead of time which, but in this particular state, equal probability, I will see up or down. So imagine I see down. Now, quantum mechanics says at that very instant and not before, when I see down, the other electron on the moon has suddenly become up. So this is kind of the non-local nature of entanglement. These two electrons are entangled, and the entanglement is highly non-local. It seems as if something I'm doing here is influencing the electron infinitely far away instantaneously. And, of course, Einstein famously said, nothing can ever go faster than the velocity of light. This seems to be superluminal. It's instantaneous. And so this can't possibly be right. Something has to go wrong with the principle of quantum mechanics when you take an entangled pair of states and separate them far apart. Okay, so that's what that paper was trying to say. And, you know, sometimes it's... So measurement of one electron instantaneously determines the state of the electron very far away. So if I see down on this side and then up on the other side. Well, the answer is this is actually what happens. I'll give a bit more evidence for it. But why is it not, and how do we come to grips with it? How is it consistent with the idea that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light? We come to grips with it by letting go of another concept that seems implicit in our reasoning, which is that these two electrons, which are in an entangled state, that somehow that state, when I have my electron here, its state lives here, and the other electron has a state that lives there. Really, there's a combined state. It doesn't live anywhere. It's shared by the both of them. It's just a state that tells you of the state of the two electrons, neither here nor there. So whether the electrons on the moon are over here, we're both looking at the same state. Nothing is going from here to there. It's just we're looking at the same object. It's a highly non-local object. So there is... you let go of the idea that the state of the universe here is determined by just things here. To really specify fully what's going on here, I really need to know the state of everything. I mean, that's really the... And the state doesn't live anywhere. It doesn't have any local sense to it. Anyway, that's enough of philosophy. So this idea is sometimes called, in fact, spooky action at a distance. For a while, I thought this is... just one of those phrases. But then a friend of mine showed me a copy of letters by Einstein written to Max Born. And this is in a book. This is a letter written in 1947. This is still 12 years later after the paper. And they talk about, okay, I can't read the German anymore. Maybe you can see it. So it's in German. But there we go. Spukhafte Fernwirkungen, whatever that is. So here's the English translation, spooky actions at a distance in German. So in fact, that is a word that Einstein himself used in this letter. And if you look more carefully at what he was saying to Born, I cannot seriously believe in it, the quantum theory, because the theory cannot be reconciled with the idea that physics should represent a reality in time and space. This is the idea of what I just tried to say less elegantly, that whatever is happening here is only dependent upon the environment here and not on the moon. It does not represent a reality in time and space, and free from spooky actions at a distance. Okay, so that's what Einstein actually said. All right, so that was in 1947. So people have thought a lot about this since then. And many careful experiments were proposed, in particular one by John Bell in the 1960s. And those experiments were eventually done in the 1980s, better and better, until the New York Times declared the battle over. As it said, this is in 2015. Sorry, Einstein, quantum studies suggest spooky action is real. So in this particular experiment, they did a version of what was just a thought experiment to Einstein in 1935. They took not two electrons, that's too hard to separate electrons without disturbing the spin, even today. They took two photons. Photons are quanta of light. And they also have an analog of spin. That's the polarization of light, whether it's going clockwise or anticlockwise. A photon going this way can have two polarizations. So you could take two photons, which get emitted this way, and then if this is clockwise, the other was anticlockwise, and vice versa. That's how you created an atom in just that way. And you take these photons apart, and you measure their polarization, and see if there's always perfect anticorrelation. In this particular experiment, they went to 1.3 kilometers. It's been much larger distances up into space now, where you can see this non-local entanglement. Okay, so the EPR paper was, amazing paper, which really focused on what the essence of quantum mechanics was. Maybe they didn't have the correct conclusion, but they certainly stimulated a lot of thought and a lot of experiment. And now I think most people would say there's no doubt at all that spooky action is real. Okay. All right. So let's move the story along. So that's with two electrons. So we went from one electron in the double slit experiment. Then we went to two electrons or two photons in the spooky action experiment. How about thousands of electrons? That's where we want. Do they get entangled in a non-local way? And that's very much a topic of current research and some of its physical consequences. But actually, one of the earliest examples of entanglement with more than two electrons, again, goes back to the 19th century. This is a picture I took of the chemist, Auguste Kekule. And what Kekule proposed was a theory of benzene. Okay, so what is benzene? Well, a chemist knew at that time benzene has six carbon and six hydrogen. They also knew that carbon likes to form four covalent bonds, and sometimes they can form a double bond. So if you take six carbons in a ring, and each carbon wants to form four covalent bonds, well, then there's a problem. You have three covalent bonds. And so where do you put that double bond? Sorry, you have three double bonds. So you put the double bond in this configuration or in this one. So which one is it? Well, if it was this one, then the hexagon would distort in a given way. If it was the other one, it would distort the other way. This bond would become shorter, say. So it wouldn't be a perfect hexagon anymore. But Kekule proposed that it was, and he used the word resonance, that it's in both. It's a superposition of both states. It's going back and forth. I think he was really imagining it resonating like an oscillator between two states. Well, that's not quite right. Well, he didn't know quantum mechanics. This is 1860s. Quantum mechanics was 1915. And anyway, so in Wikipedia, if you look this up, he talks about having a daydream of a snake seizing its own tail. And that's how he made this great discovery of the resonant structure of benzene. So fast forward to today, how would we say what Kekule said? We have the idea of superposition now. It's not really as if it's oscillating. It's really in both states at all times. So the actual state is this, we'd call resonating covalent bonds. So each bond here is a double bond. I'm only looking at the extra bond. Here we go. So this ellipse represents this state that I've been talking about so far, up, down, minus, down, up, of the two electrons, the extra fourth bond on each of these carbon atoms. And one configuration of the bonds is this, and the other is this one. And the answer is the sum or difference of the two of them. It's not resonating, but it's in both. So now we have an example in chemistry of the entanglement of six electrons. And it kind of happens in kind of a hierarchical way. The electrons entangle in pairs, and there's three of these pairs, and then they exchange partners. So no electrons is moving. So if you just look at the difference between this state and this state, no electron has ever moved. What's moved is the entanglement between them. Here, this electron, I don't know what's going on to my pointer. This electron is entangled with this one, and then its state is entangled with the other one. It doesn't actually move. It's still just sitting there. It's just entanglement is changing. Okay. So that's a structure that you get in something as simple as benzene. And now we want to take this all the way to even bigger structures. So in organic chemistry, it doesn't get much bigger than this. This is roughly what you get. But when you take solid-state physics, you take certain crystalline materials, there's now a lot of evidence that you can get entanglement really at very large distance scales. And eventually, I'll show you all the way to astrophysical sizes like black holes. So we went from the large to the small, and now we're going back up. Okay, so you may have heard of Schrödinger's cat. This is, of course, a joke, but this is now entanglement on a macroscopic scale, the superposition of a dead cat and a live cat. Okay, don't accuse me of cruelty to cats, which is what my daughter said when they saw this. No, this can never happen. And the simple reason that to entangle these two, you have to really decouple them from everything. In particular, the cats have to stop breathing. There can't be any air going in and out. That'll destroy the entanglement. So if the cats are breathing, they're both dead. It's just pretty much dead if you try to entangle it. But this was a Schrödinger's example of the extreme limit you could, in principle, take it. People can build the analog of Schrödinger's cat in the lab today with about 100 particles or something like that. So let me come back to the real world. So this is what I do. This is my day job. I worry about materials like this one. So this is yttrium barium copper oxide. It's a little pellet. It looks like a ceramic. And it's made up of very complicated sets of elements. But no worries. All of the interesting electrons here sit on the copper sites, which are these orange circles here. And furthermore, you can just take the copper sites on one layer. So you just have a square lattice of copper sites. And all of the fun stuff I'll show you happens on that square lattice. So you have electrons now moving on a square lattice rather than moving on a single hexagon. But it's essentially an infinite square lattice because this is a crystalline material you can make in the lab, and I'm sure there's little pieces of this in the lab in this building. So here's a demonstration of what the amazing thing this thing can do. So you've got these tracks which are made up of magnets, ordinary magnets, and this little cake of yttrium barium copper oxide has just been put in liquid nitrogen. So it has to be cooled down to liquid nitrogen. And then, let's see if this works. Yeah, so there it floats along. So it's a superconductor. It essentially can conduct electricity without resistance. And one consequence of that is that it floats in a magnetic field. It can also create very high magnetic fields because it can conduct currents without any resistance. Of course, eventually it collapsed, and that's because it's heated up. Once it goes above a certain temperature, around 90 Kelvin, then it's no longer superconducting. All right, so this material was discovered in 1987 when I was just starting my career as a research physicist, and I'm still working on them. Partly because of these amazing properties that they display at relatively high temperatures. So this can also have lots of benefits. So one place where people do use superconducting magnets is when you get an MRI taken. I guess in the current MRI, sorry, maybe I should just use my pointer here. Can you see that pointer? Yeah, okay. Current MRIs are not made of IBCO, but maybe in the future. There's, you know, if they are used in accelerators, in various detectors of various types, a little bit on high energy power transmission. But really, the most exciting application today is in fusion energy. So I just looked up on the web today, there's a company called Commonwealth Fusion Systems, which has raised several billion dollars of money. It's not yet public, and this is, you know, their propaganda, so take it with a grain of salt. But I think, you know, I do know a little bit about the science here, and it seems very plausible. So what they're using here, this magnet is made up of this material, yttrium barium copper oxide. So it has a property that in a very compact shape, you can create very high magnetic fields. And inside here is the plasma where fusion happens and eventually could be used as a power source. So as I say, a new high-temperature superconductor has reached industrial maturity. So the hard part is really making enough of this ceramic to make these magnets, which has been achieved. It's called rare earth barium copper oxide. I guess they don't want to use the word yttrium. I don't know why. That may spook some investors. And CFS, which is Commonwealth Fusion System, is using HTS to build its first of a kind high field large bore superconducting magnet. And this is going to lead to limitless clean fusion energy. Well, okay, that's probably a bit of hyperbole, but this could be what saves us all. Okay. So that's good enough reason for me to work on the basic physics of these materials. Okay, how am I doing on time? All right, so what's going on in these materials? Well, what's going on, in fact, we don't have a full answer yet, despite almost 30 years of work, but we've learned a lot. And the reason it's turned out to be very difficult and also very interesting is what's going on here is entanglement on a macroscopic scale. And it's very much like the idea of benzene, but now taken to bigger sizes. So what happens with these materials, you have these electrons that sit on the sides of a square lattice. So the sites, is where there's an electron on the copper atom. The copper atoms are sitting on every vertex of the square lattice. Then you change the density of mobile electrons, and only some fraction of the sites are occupied, which I've shown here. So what happens is that these electrons like to form a covalent bond, which is in this entangled pair that's been the main actor of my talk. So here's one possible pairing of these covalent bonds. And then these electrons start to move around. They don't like to be rigid at any one spot. Just the quantum uncertainty wants them to move. So they can move like that while maintaining the pairing. You want to maintain the pairing because that gains you a lot of energy. So they can move around in pairs. But also more interestingly, just like in benzene, around the square, they can exchange partners without moving, and so on. So these can also exchange this way. And all of these things happen in parallel. So if I want to write down, describe the state of all the electrons in YBCO, then I can't talk about them separately. I really have to write down an entangled state of all of them doing this dance where they're constantly exchanging partners or moving in pairs. I think intuitively that's the best I can do. So now there's a lot of theory that goes into how you describe this complicated entangled state and how does this lead to amazing phenomena here, really. How does it become a material which can expel magnetic fields and conduct current without resistance? All right, so I think we understand some of that today, but I won't go into any more details. So the basic point then of my statement is, if I just take the principles of Heisenberg and Schrödinger, which were discovered to apply the motion of one electron around a nucleus, and I just take exactly those same equations, close my eyes and work hard, and apply them to, you know, trillion electrons moving on the square lattice with the right sort of interactions, then I think most people believe you will end up, and it's not proven, but there's a lot of evidence, you will end up with a superconductor like this. And the key ingredient is really entanglement on very large length scales of the collective behavior, where I can't think of the electrons as moving separately, but being entangled to form a superconductor. All right, so that's the rough picture. But you'd like to do better. And it's very hard to do better, because not because we don't know the equations. We know the equations. They were written down by Schrödinger and Heisenberg. We know exactly the equations that need to be solved. It's just that they're very hard to solve, because they involve trillions of variables. Even the biggest computer in the world is not big enough to hold that much information and run the computation to tell us what happens quantum mechanically. There's some very fundamental obstacles towards that. So this was, you know, starting to become clear in the already in the 90s. I had this idea, let's simplify the problem. Let's try to find the simplest possible situation in which I can solve the equations of motion of electrons with infinite entanglement, with everything entangled with everything else. Can you at least find some simple situation where you can predict what will happen, where you have lots and lots of entanglement? So following Kekule's dream, I can make this not true statement. I also had a dream. And the dream is based upon this not one snake eating its own tail, but snakes going from anywhere to anywhere. So this is the old Indian game of snakes and ladders. I guess it's called chutes and ladders in America, but it's from India. It was originally called snakes and ladders. That led to what's now called the SYK model, it's a model. It's a toy model, as we call it. But it's a toy model which has two virtues. One, that it has lots of entanglement, which is what we want. And two, it can be solved. So we can actually solve the whole thing and then understand in a very reliable way what happens when you have massive multi-particle entanglement. Not just two as EPR we're thinking about, but really everything going to everything. And this model, and again, yesterday's talk, I gave a few more details about it. I didn't really go into exactly how you solve it. But today, after 20 plus years of work, all of its properties are understood. And it does describe some of the properties of IBCO very well. Not the superconductivity, but what happens when you heat it up a little bit. There's still a bunch of strange properties that people discovered, and this model gives you a lot of insight into those strange properties, which was something I discussed yesterday a little bit in the colloquium. But I can at least show you the model. It's really very much in the spirit of the EPR thought experiment, but here it's more than a thought experiment. You can solve the thing on a computer with a few tricks. So you take a bunch of positions, say these could be the copper atoms. Instead of putting them on a regular square lattice, you put them on a random positions. This is one of those places where randomness actually simplifies things. You put some electrons on some of the sites. And now you want these electrons to move around and entangle with each other. So for example, these two electrons here will move to those two sites. So there's a pair of valence bond moving. So it does that. And if I were to knew the microscopic situation, that particular process in quantum theory has a certain complex number associated with it, which we call an amplitude. So there's a certain amplitude with moving any pair of electrons to any other pair of sites. So for a given crystal or a given material, those numbers we can determine. So that's a fixed set of numbers. So there's one number there. Then you can move these to here. There's another number there, and so on. So there's about n to the 4, where n is the number of particles. numbers that I have to specify. So if you really wanted to determine everything about this particular system, I'd have to give you the list of these numbers, and then you have to put those numbers in a computer and you solve it. That's impossible. It's too hard because the number of variables is just way too large. It's exponentially large, it turns out. However, if you make a very simple assumption, and this was the main idea in 93, let's assume those numbers are random. We don't know what they are, but they're just sort of nicely distributed as random numbers. Then there's an analog of the central limit theorem that you may know about from statistics. You know, if you're taking a poll of, you know, are you Republican or Democrat, you'll get some distribution in any population, you know, and that distribution, say, between the different state has a certain shape, which has a Gaussian form. And that's independent of what the microscopic probability distributions were. There's a similar thing here. Independent of what the microscopic numbers are, there's some self-averaging behavior of these strongly entangled electrons. So I'll just leave it at that. So this can be solved because of some extension of the central limit theorem. And amazingly, when you solve it, you do get some of the properties, some understanding of some of the properties of IBCO. If you want to know more, look at the recording of my talk yesterday. All right, so let me then finish by just going even bigger. This wasn't my intention when I wrote on this model 93 with my first graduate student, Jin Mouye. But slowly over the years, it started to become clear that this actually also had something to do with black holes. So let me just now tell you a completely different story, which for a while, until the work of Stephen Hawking, didn't involve quantum mechanics. So this is just the old Newtonian theory combined with relativity. So the person who first combined the Newtonian theory of the planets with relativity was Einstein, and that combination is called general relativity. And so there's a set of classical equations very much in the Newtonian framework, except we think of not in terms of positions of particles, we think in terms of this metric of space-time itself. Space-time itself, the metric or distances and times, become our dynamical degree of freedom in what we call a field theory, which is what Einstein wrote down, generalizing the field theory of Maxwell for the theory of light. So this was an amazing achievement, but it was very much in the Newtonian framework. There wasn't any radical new idea that Newton would have not liked. Like there was in quantum mechanics. There was nothing radical like superposition at all in Einstein's theory of general relativity. So Einstein's theory was written out in 1918, and I forget, it was not soon after Schwarzschild discovered that his theory had some rather strange solutions, which we now call black holes. And the solutions were of the following form. If you take a mass M and you squeeze it down to a radius smaller than R, where g is Newton's constant, c is the velocity of light, numbers we know, then it becomes so dense, the gravity becomes so strong, that even light cannot escape from it. So anything inside the horizon is forever trapped inside, including light. So if there happens to be an atom emitting light, the light will curve back and come back. It'll never leave. So it's disconnected completely from the rest of the universe. And if you were outside, of course, you'd feel a very strong gravitational pull, and you don't want to fall in because you're never coming back. But if you're outside and looking at it safely, you will just see a completely quiescent object, just a very strong gravitational force, but nothing else happening. Okay, that's classically. Of course, you know, if you put in a few numbers, for example, if M is the Earth's mass, then if you put in the numbers, R is 9 millimeters. So this is an impossibly dense object. You have to take the entire Earth and squeeze it down to the size of a pea to make the Earth into a black hole. Not going to happen. Well, these things do happen today. Over, you know, this is 1918 some or 1920 something. Now we know that, in fact, every galaxy has a black hole in its center. including our galaxy, the Milky Way. So there's what's called a supermassive black hole at the heart of the Milky Way. This is called Sagittarius A star. And it has 4.3 million suns in it. That's how heavy it is. And the radius, if you plug into that famous formula of 2 gm over c squared, you get a radius which is whatever this is in meters. And that's about the size of the Earth's orbit around the sun. So that's on an astrophysical size, actually, that's quite small. And what you're seeing here is not this radius. What you're seeing is the light from behind the black hole bending as it acts like a lens to light. And that's what you're seeing is the lens effect, the gravitational lens effect. The actual black hole is probably just a tiny thing in the center, which really has never been seen. What we have seen is various stars around it from which you can see that there must be a black hole there. And this is just one of the closest black hole, or closest known black hole. There are probably others closer by, and many other experiments have seen evidence of these objects. All right, so that's, you know, one of, again, an amazing triumph of physics, but purely classical physics, just with Planck's constant, which is the basic constant that determines how strong quantum effects are, has been set to zero. And it works perfectly. As you know, I mean, these are discoveries only made in the last 10 years, and including black holes. But the situation is kind of unsatisfactory, because what about quantum effects? And this is a question that's famously Stephen Hawking asked in the 1970s. And his most famous work was pointing out that actually, once you include quantum effects, black holes are not really black. They're very tiny corrections to the physics of black hole. And a black hole is really like an oven which is radiating energy at a certain temperature. And eventually, you know, like a cup of coffee, it'll radiate enough energy that it'll evaporate, disappear. And this is all because of quantum effects. Of course, that time is many times longer than the age of the universe, so we don't have to worry about it for any astrophysical black hole. So these are very, very, very tiny effects, but in principle, they should be there. Okay, so and why are there quantum effects? So one way to understand them is to take our favorite experiment of taking an entangled pair of electrons and separating them, putting one inside a black hole. That's the ultimate of moving things apart. You have an entangled pair. You throw one inside the black hole over there, and you keep the other one. So that's gone forever. But quantum mechanics says they're still entangled. You know, if this is down, that's up. And if that's down, this is up. And so on. Up, OK, I said the same thing twice, but you know what I mean. So they're entangled. But now there's a big difference. Suppose there are, you know, an observer happens to be sitting here, and you're sitting safely outside the black hole. So that observer will see down, and you will see up, or vice versa. How do I oscillate that thing? There we go. So that observer will see up, and you see down, or that observer will see down, and you see up. However, there's a difference now. That observer inside can never tell me what they saw, because they're inside a black hole. They can't send me any information. So as far as I'm concerned, this particular bit, this electron, is not entangled with anything, because my universe ends here. The part of the universe I can communicate with is right here, ends there. So I have now an electron with me, which is truly random. It's neither up nor down. It's both. But it's not because it's entangled with something else. It's in what we call a mixed state, not a pure state. And when you have something in a mixed state, or random, then that's entropy and temperature. So there's a temperature, I'm sure you know, from thermodynamics, is just randomness. So there's a truly random object here, not an entangled object. And a truly random object means that there's a temperature. So a black hole is like a black body with a certain temperature. And this was Hawking's great discovery. I should say Bekenstein had similar ideas earlier. Hawking actually gave a number. He computed it precisely what the temperature and the entropy of a black hole is. All right, so so this is happening all the time between the inside and outside of a black hole. So in some sense, a black hole is the ultimate in strong non-local entanglement. It's non-local because it's from the region in the other universe almost, inside the black hole, to your universe, which is outside the black hole, hopefully. Okay. All right, so now what does this do with the SYK model? Well, they turned out to be an amazing fact, which I first had an inkling of in 2010, and now through the work of Kitev, the K of SYK and others, it has been very precisely established. So what happens is that if I take a particular type of black hole, which has a net charge, so that's technical, I won't go into. If you're falling into this kind of black hole, then your space out here is three-dimensional. I need the angular coordinates x and zeta to describe my space-time. But as I'm falling in, as I get closer to the horizon, it's as if the x direction doesn't matter. So if you're falling into such a certain class of black hole, you will feel as if your world is one-dimensional. There's only one line along which you're falling. And the other dimensions are just invisible to you. So that's, okay, that may be unfortunate for you, but it's fortunate for the theorist because solving quantum mechanics along a line is always a lot easier than solving quantum mechanics in three dimension. And in this case, you can actually solve for quantum gravity along this line. And when you solve it, you get a certain set of equations. And amazingly, those equations are exactly the equations you get to describe the entanglement on this model I showed you, the SYK model, just random entanglement of electrons. They're the same equations. So that's tremendously exciting. And so this then tells you a lot more about the structure of entanglement across a black hole horizon. Okay. And this has led to a lot of progress, mostly been worked by other people, where many of the problems with Hawking's original papers, in the sense, Hawking himself said, something is wrong here, something's got to go wrong when the black hole keeps evaporating. Eventually, quantum mechanics must break down. So at least for these type of black hole, we know that's not true. Quantum mechanics has survived the test with no changes, even in a black hole, despite Hawking's doubts in 1975. Okay, so I think I'll finish there. So the bottom line is that this toy model that I came up with in 93 has this all-to-all entanglement. Everything's entangled with everything in some kind of scale-invariant way. And amazingly, that same set of equations to describe all-to-all entanglement not only describes the certain electrical properties of IBCO, but it also describes in a dual set of variables the dynamics of how black holes evaporate. Okay, so I'll conclude there. So what I started with, just starting with this theory of electrons of Schrödinger and Heisenberg in a hydrogen atom, and then we went from there to theory of electrons in a benzene molecule, and then to pairs of electrons in a superconductor like YBCO, and as we scaled up, we started getting entanglement really at all distances. And there's an amazing connection then between, there's some kind of universality, as we say. Once things become enough entangled, they have this new type of emergent behavior that seems to have close connections in very different physical systems, including this strange behavior of YBCO and also the entanglement in a black hole between the inside and outside as it's evaporating. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. And we have time for questions. If there are any, just raise your hand and I'll bring you the microphone and you can ask your question. So people are absorbing this. Okay. The fact that this little ceramic piece, we have this racetrack thing.
I'm sure you do. Yes, great. I should have asked.
And somehow you look at this thing and you formulate
a theory that describes that, and the same math and the same theory works in a black hole. It's just a stunning thing. So any questions? Anyone want to ask any questions? Ah, someone on Zoom. Guess you can go ahead.
Our entangled pair, happened
there?
We
should read it, I guess. Can you click the chat?
Are entangled pairs of electrons in the superconductor the same as Cooper pairs? Yes. So what's different is in the old superconductors, you get these entangled pairs, but then they just move around as pairs. In the new superconductors, they actually keep exchanging partners. That's really entanglement. So if you just move around in pairs independently, then you have only pairwise entanglement. So in the old superconductors, roughly speaking, there's only pairwise entanglement. Not much more than in the EPR, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment. But when they keep exchanging pairs, it's like benzene to the max. Benzene at 6, this really has an infinite number. Yeah. You have a question here?
Oh. Yeah. Yes,
just a second.
Yeah, maybe use the mic.
Sorry. So what I was basically thinking was, as someone who's taking organic chemistry, I have to draw benzene rings, and I just draw the little donut model as to show it's like in all these, it's like in all the, they're localized, they're in all the state at once, right? Could that be like similarly applied to like the whole of the superconductor? Like they're all in these same states, all entangled with each other?
The answer is yes. Now, benzene, so the question was, maybe I don't know if the mic is on. Question was, can I take this superposition like in a benzene ring and just extend that theory to YBCO?
Just like all of them?
The short answer is yes, but what happens is the state is so complicated to write down. You could write it down in principle as a variation
very
of state.
Big, right?
It's hard to compute with it. You still need a lot of tools to understand the properties of this massively entangled state. So we have a picture of it, but a picture is not a theory.
That must be so frustrating.
Yes, well, it was that desperation that led me to think, well, forget about the square lattice, let's just make it totally random. Somehow that led to something anyway. It hasn't solved the original problem, but it's led to some progress.
And I hope we can solve that original problem one day.
Well, I'll leave it for you. Yes, I think certainly we'd like to solve the original problem.
Okay, we have another question on Zoom, Professor Sachdev. I can read it for you. How do we entangle the pairs to begin with? That's the question.
Well, that's a good question. So, for example, if I go back to this experiment here where you have an entangled pair of photons, so in this experiment, what did they do? Well, you have to find a certain transition, you know, a certain two energy levels in a molecule where the physics of an electron will go from one energy level to a down energy level, and that particular transition always gives off two photons. It's a two-photon transition. Given that fact that giving off two photons and the fact that the transition has to conserve angular momentum and momentum pretty much says they have to be entangled. That's what quantum mechanics would say. And also the fact that the two photons are indistinguishable from each other, then there's really no other possible state that they come out. So ultimately, it's the underlying laws of physics in the right physical situation which entangle them. Now, so that's also what's happening here, in benzene also. It's something to do with the fact that each carbon atom has four bonds, and then there's two configurations that are closer in energy, and then you find you can lower the energy by resonating them. That's what. So the underlying laws of physics naturally lead to entanglement. And the same is true in YBCO. We know a lot about how the copper atoms interact with each other. There's some similarities to what happens in carbon, in benzene, and that just leads to this state. However, but that's a great question, what if you could actually manufacture entanglement in the lab and not just accept what nature gives us. That is the whole idea of quantum computing, where people are trying to manufacture entanglement by doing very special, careful operations on qubits in a quantum computer. That's much, much harder because you have to be very careful to isolate your system from its environment. Just like in the Schrödinger cat experiment, you have the only way you get a dead cat and a live cat together is by completely isolating the cat from everything outside the cat. So you have to do what's called quantum error correction to compensate for the effect of the environment. And that's, of course, a huge effort today. Again, with many companies worth a lot of money trying to do this, promising the world. We'll see if they get there. So entanglement for this quantum computing is really, again, another example of the uses of entanglement, but you're using entanglement that you create yourself, and that's a lot harder. I'm much less ambitious. I'm just accepting the entanglement that's there and trying to understand it.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, anything else?
There's one more question.
Give me a second, please.
So, are they independent of gravity? Because, like, if you have a clock outside of the Earth, it ticks slower or faster. Do mm-hmm. they change any faster, or are they still locked to each other?
That's a great question. So, what you're referring to, a clock's moving slower in a gravitational field, that's a purely classical effect. That's, again, does not require quantum mechanics. So that effect would be present even if you moved if you took one pair of the one electron from an entangled pair in a strong gravitational field and the other not, then they would have slightly different clocks. And this would change the entanglement, but it wouldn't destroy it. It would just change the phase factor between them, for example.
Okay, last chance. Anyone have a question? No, I guess we have our last questions from Zoom again. So,
was there a question there?
I think it may be a comment. Thank you for the
many worlds of Copenhagen.
Oh, there we go.
This is a question about the theory of measurements. Well, in a sense, you know, I'm much more of a this is more of a philosophical question, and I'm not a philosopher, because. You know, I view the quantum theory as a theory of which predicts experiments and predicts correlations between different experiments. Now, you know, there's this idea that when you collapse, what happens when you measure something, look at something? Well, as I said, before you looked at it, it was either up or down. You look at it and you find it's up. So what's happened then? Well, I think what's happened then is that your brain or yourself have gotten entangled with the electrons. So there's a part of the wave function, if you wish, which is the electrons up, and you're seeing it's up. Okay, but there's another part of the wave function where you saw it's down, and the electron is down. So that's the other world. Is it there? It's kind of a meaningless question in my point of view. We only talk about observations, and quantum mechanics is a theory of correlations between observations. I don't want to go into what you didn't observe. It's not a meaningful question. As it is, you know, it's a very bizarre theory. It's writing down these complicated wave functions and equations of motion, partial differential equations. And are the little electrons actually, is that all of that real? I don't know. I can't imagine the electrons know about all these complicated mathematics. That's more of a philosophical question. But we are forced to talk about things, use a language for things we ascribe a reality to, but I'm not sure. The only thing that's real are the measurements and the correlations between different measurements. And as long as you just talk about that, then this is not a question that arises. even in the Maxwell theory, they talk about electric fields and magnetic fields. We do that very easily. Well, have you ever seen an electric field? Is it really there? Is it really an electric field? I don't even know what that means. it's a very useful concept to tell us how a charge will move when you have an electric field. So it's a very useful intermediate idea. And the state of a quantum system is also, I think, in a similar category. It's a more subtle, but it's in a similar category.
Okay, why don't we end here on that provocative comment on on the quantum view of nature. So thank you very much again, Professor Sachdev, for a wonderful talk. And thank you all for coming to the 2022 Spring Peterson Lecture. Stay tuned for future lectures.